anywhere in the world, he chose to bring about a peaceful political revolution through universal adult suffrage. India is one of the few countries in the world where political transformation happened more rapidly than economic or social transformation. A large number of nations that gained freedom around the same time also adopted democratic system of government, but India is one of the very few nations that have been able to strengthen its democratic ethos. What India's constitution and constitutionalists like Surendranath Banerjee, Justice M.G. Ranade, Firoz M. Sameta had brought into conception in the first quarter of the 19th century, then effectively brought to completion in 1950s. India attained freedom in August 1947, and 2 years later set up an election commission under Article 324 of the Constitution.
क्या आपको उम्मीद है इस करंट 2020 से क्योंकि शुरुआत
विदिन नेक्स्ट मंथ द रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ द पीपल एक्ट वाज पास इन पार्लियामेंट व्हाइल मूविंग द एक्ट प्राइम मिनिस्टर पंडित जवाहरलाल नेहरू एक्सप्रेस द होप दैट इलेक्शन वुड बी हेल्ड एज अर्ली एज द स्प्रिंग ऑफ 1951. इट इज इंपॉर्टेंट टू नोट बिफोर इलेक्शन कमीशन वॉज एस्टैब्लिश्ड in independent India, the seeds of institutionalizing the mechanism were every Indian above the age of 21 had the right to vote was already mooted and deliberated upon. The Motilal Nehru Committee on a draft constitution for India advocated unlimited adult franchise and equal rights for women. The resolution of 1931 Karachi session of Indian National Congress, presided over by Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel, regarded the affirmation of political equality encapsulated in the notion of universal adult franchise as fundamental to the future of Purna Swaraj. The Roundtable Conference on the Future of India that took place in 1931-32 led to the creation of the Indian Franchise Committee, headed by the Marquis of Lothian, Parliamentary Under Secretary of State for British India, to advise on an expanded and more equitable election system. The committee was forced to agree that universal adult franchise was the only really fair way to conduct elections, but they could not see how this could be easily implemented in India. The committee agreed upon desirability as indeed the need of universal adult suffrage as the basis of democracy. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, while the stance of franchise committee vindicated the stance for India native polity at large, what is really significant though is that the idea of universal adult suffrage boiled down to how make an illiterate voter identify his choice of vote. This obviously was based on their experience in British elections, but what they worried about the effects of illiteracy on the electorate. They also considered that this need not prevent people from voting because they had the example of Ceylon to show how this could be done. The Ceylon system, also known as the colored box symbol system, made it unnecessary for the voters, whether literate or illiterate, to make any mark on the ballot paper. He or she had merely to place it in the box marked with the color of symbol of the candidate of their choice. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, when India chose to adopt a democracy, this form of government was confined to a narrow spectrum of industrially and educationally advanced nations of the world. Even there the numbers had dwindled to mere 12 by 1942, down from 29 in 1922, due to the rise of authoritarianism, Nazism and fascism in Italy, Germany, and its satellite states. In fact, after the Treaty of Westphalia in 1746, there was a wave of democratic movement on the basis of equal right of voting and formation of the nation states. 1848 revolutions rolled these historic events of socio-economic political transformation whole of Europe. But unfortunately, because of the rise of Nazism and Fascism, the number dwindled to 12 by 1942, down from 29 in 1922. Due to the rise of the authoritarian regime in Italy, Germany, and satellite vessels, the Allied victory in the World War II, 1945, opened up the way for re-democratization. Yet in the case of India, the enlistment of 36 crores voters as per census of 1951 were constituted almost one-sixth of the world population to the cause of democracy was a mammoth exercise. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the world watched disbelievingly as the Indian elections commenced over a span of 4 months from 25th October 1951 to 21st February 1952. It was the biggest democratic exercise in history at that point. Sukumar Sen walked undaunted by cynicism, and the Cassandras of doom felt that a nation with sub-17% illiteracy was not fit for adults universal suffrage. Let me share with you the kind of criticism and cynicism India's democratic exercise was facing from the skeptics. Winston Churchill, in his infamously speech, argued that in handing over the government of India to those so-called political classes, we are handing over to men of straw, of who, in a few years, will have no trace, will remain, unquote. Similarly, American scholar journalist Seligas Harrison had said that the odds are almost wholly against the survival of freedom, and the issue is, in fact, whether any Indian state can survive at all. Sorry. The British General Claude Auchinleck, who was the Supreme Commander of the Indian Armed Forces, reportedly wrote in 1948, I quote, the Sikhs may try to set up separate regime, and that will be only a start of general disintegration and break up of the idea that India is a country where it is a subcontinent as varied as Europe. The Punjabi is as different from a Madrasi as a Scot is from an Italian. The British tried to consolidate it, but achieved nothing permanent. No one can make a nation out of a continent of many nations, unquote. Even 9 years of the first general, after the first general election, Aldous Huxley, the great writer of Brave New World, declared, and I quote, when Nehru goes, the government will become a military dictatorship, as in so many of the newly independent states, for the army seems to be the only highly organized center of power, unquote. Even after the fourth general election, the London Times wrote in 1967 that, I quote, the great experiment of developing India within a democratic framework has failed. Indians will soon vote in the fourth and surely last general election, unquote. Friends, not only were all these highbrowed Cassandras proven wrong, but we can, with some collective pride and satisfaction, say that these detractors were proved wrong by the people of India. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the Constituent Assembly of India intensely debated the issue of universal adult suffrage. It unhesitatingly adopted the principle of adult suffrage despite the difficulties prove involved. In an extensive report on the first general election, Sen wrote that granting votes to one and all was an act of faith. I quote, faith in the common man of India and in his practical common sense. The decision launched a great and faithful experiment, unique in the world in its stupendousness and complexities. Once again, I congratulate you, sir, for bringing out the first report of Sukumar Sen on the first general election. Sukumar Sen spoke of the first election as the highest experiment of democracy in human history, unquote. It was an exercise massive logistic proportions. The electorate comprised around 176 million individuals, of whom 86% were illiterate, was just not one election, but two, since provincial assemblies were also elected in the same time. A house-to-house survey was undertaken to register the voters. About 10 lakh officials were assigned duties to supervise the proceedings. Nearly 6.2 crores ballot papers were printed. Over 2,24,000 polling booths, one assigned almost for over 1,000 voters, were established. 2.5 million plus still ballot boxes were made. candidates from over 14 national and 63 regional or local parties and a large number of independents contested for 489 seats in the Lok Sabha and 3,283 seats in the state assemblies. 98 seats in the Lok Sabha and 669 seats in the state assemblies were reserved for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. I'm repeating it. 17,500 candidates from over 14 national and 63 regional or local parties and a large number of independents contested for 489 seats in the Lok Sabha and 3,283 seats in the state assemblies. 98 seats in the Lok Sabha and 669 seats in the state assemblies were reserved for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. As a concession to the scheduled caste and tribe, some constituencies were to elect two members from the same seat, one general and one caste or tribal. In North Bengal, today's Kuchbihar seat actually elected three members, one scheduled caste, one scheduled tribe, and one general. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, boxes, one for each candidate, given the colored task of producing over 21.5 lakh steel ballot boxes, one for each candidate. Even the private sector pitched in. Godrej has leased a village at Bhigroli in Bombay, suburb areas comprising a roofed area of 2,33,000 square feet for making these ballot boxes. The factory had to churn out more than 15,000 ballot boxes a day. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, over 16,500 clerks were needed to type up and collate the electoral rolls. About 3,80,000 names of paper were used to print the rolls. 2,24,000 members of the people of the Polish would be required to prevent violence and intimidation. The electorate was spread over an area of more than a million square miles, and in places the terrains made the exercise horrendously difficult. Bridges had to be specially constructed across rivers to reach remote hill villages. Naval vessels would be required to carry the rolls to the voting booths in small islands in the Indian Ocean. History records how people from the remotest corners of the country, be in the nomads of Kutch, for whom special booths were built in the sweltering desert, and the tribals of Odisha who came to the voting booths with bows and arrows, while the Nagas trekked the hills for days, they knew what they were voting for, a country that would include the rights of all Indians without bias or exception. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, India's history with democracy is a story which needs to be told time and again. But complacency enables authoritarian tendencies to gain ground. We are a nation of 12,69,219 square miles, practicing 7 major religions, speaking 122 languages and 1,600 dialects in our everyday lives, belonging to 3 major ethnic groups, Caucasians, Mongoloids and Dravidians, expressed by the Constitution of India. The deepening and diffusion of democracy in India did not go without the share of challenges. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to underline 5 such instances when the maturity of Indian democracy assimilated even the most anarchic of the views and helped in strengthening our intrinsic belief in the democratic ethos and values. To my mind, the foremost achievement of the first general election lies in the fact it cemented painstakingly brought about unification of India. Despite the complex arrangement of categorization of states under Part A, B, C and D, the provinces, states and union territories and the areas, the entire geographical territory of India voted as a singular electorate, electing for themselves a single union of parliament. Of course, by the time the second general elections happened, the complex categorization of the areas and provinces were done with, since there are just the states and union territories in existence. Our geographical electoral map have changed only when the territories associated with the Pondicherry in 1954, Goa, Daman and Diu in 1961, and Sikkim in 1975 joined the Indian Union. B. The participation of the Communist Party of India on the Constituent Assembly elections, even though they were principally opposed to it. Another victory of Indian democracy, democratic principles, was successful suppression of the radical and violent rebellion in Naxalbari through the ballot paper. Democracy in India also gave rise to identify identity-based politics. Purely from the lens of deepening democracy, I see this as a positive development because it leads to wider representation. However, an electorate divided in caste and community lines throws up the polarized mandate, which may not be desirable. Indian democracy and its inherent power of assimilation has successfully thwarted insurgency and separate movement, and elections have successfully co-opted varied groups into the electoral mainstream. The Punjab Accord, Shillong Accord, Mizo Accord, Assam Accord, and the recent agreement on Brood Young People are examples of the same. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Indian democracy has been tested time and again, the last few months have witnessed people come out in the streets in large numbers, particularly the young, to voice out their views on issues which in their opinion are important. Their assertion and belief in the Constitution of India is particularly heartening to see. Consensus is the lifeblood of democracy. Democracy thrives on listening, deliberating, discussing, arguing, even dissenting. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's my firm belief that all this could be achieved because we fiercely upheld and maintained the sanctity and supremacy of elections and the electoral process. This indeed could not have been possible without the institutional framework headed by the Election Commission of India. In my opinion, the Election Commission of India, respected and revered by the people and feared by the participants in elections, has mostly stood the test of time. The role of Election Commission, in particularly play of democracy in India, has been simply outstanding. The challenge it has had to face have been daunting. The management of an electorate of over 900 million in 2019 and ensuring fair polling over 10,36,000 polling stations is not an easy job. I compliment the Election Commission for the laudable achievement of conducting the 17 general elections and subsequent elections to the state assemblies. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, day after will be National Voters Day. The voter is the central actor in any democratic election. I am happy to note that Election Commission of India has taken several initiatives to make the process of enrollment easier, convenient, and the voting exercise people-friendly. After having smoothly conducted 17 general elections to Lok Sabha and almost 400 elections for the state legislative assemblies, the Election Commission finds itself in an enviable position with 5 to 6 states going to election every year. The Election Commission of India is never at rest. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, any lecture on electoral process of India would be incomplete without underlying the outstanding contribution of the women and men at the helm. I'd like specially to mention former Chief Election Commissioners Kalyan Sundaram, Shri S.P. Sen Varma, who managed to conduct elections in 1969 in the midst of Naxal fury, Shri T.N. Seshan, for bringing about far-reaching and much-needed reforms, and Shri G.M. Lindo for setting right the universal election system. I'm sorry for my bad throat. We must look at the challenges that our electoral system, as indeed our democracy, faces. I would like to accordingly underline a few. The hindrance of development process caused by the frequent invocation of the Model Code of Conduct. It could be taken care by amending the Model Code of Conduct appropriately and ensuring that no developmental work is stopped simply because of the fact that the elections are taking place. 2. Disproportionate large size of the electorate vis-à-vis a number of public representatives. The last enhancement of the seats in Lok Sabha and Assembly took place in 1977, almost a century ago, on the basis of 1971 census, when the population of country was 55 crores. Today we are 1.3 billion people, and even a proportionate increase would take the number of seats in Lok Sabha to more than 1,000. The adequate representation of women in parliament and the assemblies has emerged as a major area of concern and calls for the immediate passage of the Women's Representation Bill. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Election Commission has served its purpose rather well, and any attempt at its denigration will amount to denigrating the electoral process itself. There can be no room for speculation that challenge the very basis of our democracy. People's mandate is sacrosanct and has to be above any iota of reasonable doubt. A firm believer in their institutions, it is my considered opinion that the workmen who decide how institutional tools perform, the onus of ensuring institutional integrity in this case lies with the Election Commission of India. They must do so and put any speculation at rest. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, our experiment with democracy based on universal adult suffrage has not only continued despite hindrances, but has deepened and spread with regular elections of panchayat and urban local bodies. The answer to this success lies in the wisdom and the resilience of our people, strength of our institutions, and above all, maturity of our political classes, which has to be very large extent adhered to our guiding civilizational principle, Satyameva Jayate. Jai Hind. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Once again, I pay my most respectful homage to Sukumar Sen. Thank you. Please don't get up. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Most Honourable Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, sir, for your exhaustive and informative address. May I now request the Chief Election Commissioner, Mr. Sunil Arora, to please present you with a small token of appreciation. Thank you very much, sir. May I now request the Election Commissioner, Mr. Sushil Chandra, to please give the vote of thanks.
Honorable former President of India, Shri Pranab Mukherjee Sahib, Honorable Chief Election Commissioner, Shri Sunil Arora, Honorable Election Commissioner Shri Ashok Lavasa, the family of Shri Sukumar Sen, the former CECs, ECs, distinguished guests. First and foremost, I, on behalf of Election Commission of India, and on my behalf, would like to express our sincere gratitude to Honorable former President Shri Pranab Mukherjee for delivering the inaugural lecture of Sukumar Sen Memorial Lecture Series. This is a historic day for the Commission, as this is the first lecture in this series. His talk about the contribution made by Shri Sen, the first Chief Election Commissioner, which does continue being relevant for the electoral democracy in the largest democracy of the world, is very enlightening. Sir, the challenges which you have posed before the Election Commission have also been noted for the future compliance. I am also thankful to the former President for releasing the reprint of narrative report of first general election and a postage stamp on this occasion. I am grateful for the presence of family members of our first Chief Election Commissioner who have come all the way from Kolkata and USA. International delegates from various election management bodies, political parties who are one of the major stakeholders in elections, secretaries and senior officers of the Government of India, eminent personalities from various sectors in the society, the special observers, friends from media who are the pillars of democracy. all of you who have spared time to attend this lecture series, we are really grateful for the same. It is a proud moment for us in Commission to commemorate the legacy of our first Chief Election Commissioner, and we will continue with the tradition begin today for future to invoke the ideals, vision, commitment and hard work to preserve the constitutional obligation bestowed on the Commission. Thank you once again for making this event successful. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise now for the national anthem.
I cannot see the whole thing because of my poor health, but I am glad that my full speech has been circulated to all of you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, sir. Please rise for the national anthem.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya He Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jaladhi Taranga Tava Shubha Name Jage शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
Kindly remain in your places until the former president and other dignitaries have left the dais.
Namaskar. परीक्षा का तनाव खत्म करने के लिए छात्रों के साथ प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी का परीक्षा पे चर्चा का कार्यक्रम का तीसरा संस्करण दिल्ली के ताल कटोरा स्टेडियम में बस अब कुछ ही पलों में शुरू होने वाला है। प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी कार्यक्रम में हिस्सा लेने के लिए ताल कटोरा स्टेडियम पहुंच चुके हैं और आपको बता दें कि इस समय ये सीधी तस्वीरें आप देख रहे हैं। बस कुछ ही पलों में प्रधानमंत्री छात्रों से बातचीत करते नजर आएंगे, उन्हें गुरु मंत्र देते नजर आएंगे और ताल कटोरा स्टेडियम पहुंच चुके हैं। इस कार्यक्रम में करीब 2000 छात्र और शिक्षक हिस्सा ले रहे हैं। इनमें से 1050 छात्रों का चयन निबंध प्रतियोगिता के जरिए किया गया है और ये सीधी तस्वीरें आप दिल्ली के ताल कटोरा स्टेडियम से देख रहे हैं जहां प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी पहुंच चुके हैं और वो आज परीक्षा पे चर्चा करते नजर आएंगे।